Have you ever been really excited to purchase something you wanted, only to find that it was sold out? Or worse, watched someone take the last item you wanted off the shelf before your very eyes, ripping your heart out in the process? That has totally not happened to me, by the way. I am not bitter about it at all. Okay, I think I need a minute. Sometimes people happen to want the same thing at the same time. In nature, living organisms also want a lot of the same things as well, and there's not always enough to go around. In today's lesson, we'll be exploring this concept as we describe four ways organisms interact with each other to obtain resources, explain how food webs are built, and analyze how the flow of energy affects the structure of ecosystems. Let's get into it. In our previous lesson, we learned that living things are organized into communities, and that there are three main roles that living things play within their environment: producer, consumer, and decomposer. The question then becomes, how do these organisms interact with each other? To answer this, we need to understand how competition works between living things. Within every ecosystem, resources are limited, forcing living things to compete for them. The rarer the resource, the greater the competition for it. For example, competition for water is much more fierce in a desert as opposed to in a rainforest. Organisms compete over a wide variety of things, but what these resources really boil down to is survival. Remember, natural selection says that individuals that are better adapted to their environment tend to survive and reproduce. Not every living thing can achieve this. There's a lot at stake, so living things interact in ways that increase their chances of survival. Sometimes, these interactions involve very close contact between different species, called symbiosis. There are three forms of symbiosis we will discuss in this lesson. The first is parasitism, which is when one organism benefits and the other is harmed. The parasite does not immediately kill its host, but lives on it or within it, helping itself to resources over time. An example of this is a roundworm or tick feeding on a host. The parasite benefits by obtaining food, and the host is harmed by losing resources. On the other hand, there is mutualism, which is when both organisms benefit from the exchange. One example of this is the relationship between the oxpecker and large mammals like the antelope. The oxpecker feeds on parasites on the antelope's body, such as ticks and flies. The oxpecker gets food, and the antelope rids itself of pests. A win-win. Finally, there's commensalism, where one organism benefits and the other is not affected. A common example of this is when a bird makes a nest in a tree. The bird benefits by obtaining shelter, and the tree is not affected. What kind of symbiotic relationship do you think is occurring here? If you said mutualism, you're correct. A butterfly obtains nutrients from the plant's nectar, and the plant is able to spread its pollen to other plants. As you may have noticed, a common characteristic of symbiotic relationships is that the members involved generally survive the interaction. However, not all interactions end this way. Predation is when one organism, the predator, kills and eats another organism, the prey. As a result, energy and resources are transferred from the prey to the predator. This exchange can be traced using a food chain, which is a linear or one-way model that shows how food resources are transferred through living things. Food chains start with a producer, such as an oak tree, that creates food using photosynthesis. From there, a primary consumer, such as a mouse, eats this food, moving the energy along the chain. The secondary consumer, a snake in this example, eats the primary consumer. A tertiary consumer eats the secondary consumer, and so on and so forth. A food chain can vary in length, and there are typically many food chains within an ecosystem. When food chains are put together, they create a food web, which is a model that represents all the feeding relationships within a community of organisms. Keep in mind, however, that a food web does not stop at the top consumer. Food resources are only borrowed by living things and are eventually returned to the environment via decomposers, completing the cycle. Both food chains and food webs are important because they provide valuable insights into the complex relationships between different species in an ecosystem. This can help us better understand the various roles of species within a system, as well as the flow of resources. Additionally, by using a visual model, we can better understand how disturbances, such as removing one species, will affect the rest of the ecosystem. For example, what do you think will happen if we remove this one producer from this food web? Pause the video and write your thoughts in your guided notes. Removing this producer affects all the primary consumers that rely on it, as well as all the secondary consumers that eat them, and the tertiary consumers that eat the secondary consumers. That's all from removing just one producer. Okay, so we've talked about how food webs are built, and we've established that species are dependent on each other and the availability of resources. However, there is one important resource that we have not yet discussed in detail: the supply of energy. You may have noticed that most food webs do not contain many consumers at or higher than the tertiary level. Can you guess why? Write your thoughts in your guided notes. If you said it's because the supply of energy is limited, you're correct. To better understand how this works, let's take a look at an energy pyramid, which is a model that shows specifically how energy moves through living things. The shape of the pyramid reflects how energy is lost to the environment at each level. When one organism eats another, only 10% of the energy is transferred through digestion. The other 90% is lost as heat. In ecosystems, this means primary consumers only get 10% of the energy that producers create. Secondary consumers only get 10% of that, or 1%. By the time the energy reaches tertiary consumers, almost all of the original energy has been lost or returned to the environment. Studying these models gives us a better idea of how many levels of consumers an ecosystem can realistically support, providing valuable insight into the structure of food chains and food webs. Additionally, energy pyramids clearly illustrate that all energy is only borrowed by living things and eventually returned to the environment. So next time you find yourself surrounded by nature, take a look around. How do all the living things you see interact with each other to create your local ecosystem? And with that, we have wrapped up our lesson on food webs. We've learned that resources within an ecosystem are limited, creating competition over them. Species interact in ways that help them obtain the resources needed to survive. When species interact closely, it's called symbiosis. Some examples of symbiosis are parasitism, mutualism, and commensalism. On the other hand, predation is an interaction where one organism kills and eats another. These interactions are depicted by models called food webs, which show all the feeding relationships within a community of organisms. Consumers are divided into levels, such as primary and secondary consumers, and the amount of energy available at each level is only 10% of that of the previous level, with the rest lost as heat. An energy pyramid is a model that helps us visually understand this flow of energy. In our next lesson, we'll dive deeper into ecology as we examine how changes, both small and large, can affect ecosystems over time. Until then, I'm Anthony, and remember, life is full of wonders, so keep learning and don't ever stop wondering. Hey, hey.